Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Journey to the Center of the Earth by Jules Verne, narrated by Norman Dietz. This performance is copyrighted 1988 by Recorded Books, Incorporated. Of all fictions, Northrop Frye observed, the marvelous journey is the one formula that is never exhausted. It was a formula that Jules Verne perfected. From the Earth to the Moon, 2,000 leagues under the sea, around the world in 80 days, and more than 60 others, which Verne referred to as his voyage extraordinaire. Verne wrote during the second half of the 19th century, a time of great global exploration, and in his heroes we find the fictional counterparts of Stanley and Livingston, Amundsen and Scott. Verne, who loved to include all the latest scientific discoveries and speculations in his books, was a great fan of Edgar Allan Poe, who in turn was a believer in the theories of one John Cleves Sims. Sims expounded the idea that the Earth was hollow, and entrances to its core could be found at the as-yet-undiscovered poles of the globe. Sims had many followers besides Poe and Verne. He inspired at least one journey to Antarctica in search of the pole and the entrance it should mark. Edgar Allan Poe, inspired by Sims' idea, created his only work of long fiction, The Narrative of Arthur Gordon Pym. Jules Verne, with like inspiration, gave us Journey to the Center of the Earth.
Chapter 1. My Uncle Makes a Great Discovery. Looking back to all that's occurred to me since that eventful day, I'm scarcely able to believe in the reality of my adventures. They were truly so wonderful that even now I'm bewildered when I think of them. My uncle was a German, having married my mother's sister, an Englishwoman. Being very much attached to his fatherless nephew, he invited me to study under him in his home in the fatherland. This home was in a large town, and my uncle, a professor of philosophy, chemistry, geology, mineralogy, and many other ologies. One day, after passing some hours in the laboratory, my uncle being absent at the time, I suddenly felt the necessity of renovating the tissues. That's to say, I was hungry and was about to rouse up our old French cook, when my uncle, Professor von Hardwigg, suddenly opened the street door and came rushing upstairs. Now, Professor Hardwigg, my worthy uncle, is by no means a bad sort of man. He is, however, choleric and original. To bear with him means to obey, and scarcely had his heavy feet resounded within our joint domicile than he shouted for me to attend upon him. "Harry! Harry! Harry!" I hastened to obey. But before I could reach his room, jumping three steps at a time, he was stamping his right foot upon the landing. "Harry!" he cried in a frantic tone. "Are you coming up?" Now, to tell the truth, at that moment, I was far more interested in the question as to what was to constitute our dinner than in any problem of science. To me, soup was more interesting than soda, an omelet more tempting than arithmetic, and an artichoke of 10 times more value than any amount of asbestos. But my uncle was not a man to be kept waiting. So, adjourning, therefore, all minor questions, I presented myself before him. He was a very learned man. Now, most persons in this category supply themselves with information as peddlers do with goods, for the benefit of others, and lay up stores in order to diffuse them abroad for the benefit of society in general. Not so my excellent uncle, Professor Hardwigg. He studied, he consumed the midnight oil, he pored over heavy tomes and digested huge quartos and folios in order to keep the knowledge acquired to himself. There was a reason, and it may be regarded as a good one, why my uncle refused to display his learning more than was absolutely necessary. He stammered, and when intent upon explaining the phenomena of the heavens, was apt to find himself at fault and allude in such a vague way to sun, moon, and stars that few were able to comprehend his meaning. To tell the honest truth, When the right word wouldn't come, it was generally replaced by a very powerful adjective. In connection with the sciences, there are many almost unpronounceable names, names very much resembling those of Welsh villages. And my uncle, being very fond of using them, his habit of stammering was not thereby improved. In fact, there were periods in his discourse when he'd finally give up and swallow his discomfiture in a glass of water. As I said, my uncle, Professor Hardwigg, was a very learned man. And I now add a most kind relative. I was bound to him by the double ties of affection and interest. I took deep interest in all his doings, and hoped someday to be almost as learned myself. It was a rare thing for me to be absent from his lectures. Like him, I preferred mineralogy to all the other sciences. My anxiety was to gain real knowledge of the earth. Geology and mineralogy were to us the sole objects of life. And in connection with these studies, many a fair specimen of stone, chalk, or metal did we break with our hammers. Steel rods, lodestone, glass pipes, and bottles of various acids were oftener before us than our meals. My uncle Hardwigg was once known to classify 600 different geological specimens by their weight, hardness, fusibility, sound, taste, and smell. He corresponded with all the great learned and scientific men of the age. I was, therefore, in constant communication with, at all events, the letters of Sir Humphrey Davy, Captain Franklin, and other great men. But before I state the subject on which my uncle wished to confer with me, I must say a word about his personal appearance. Alas, you will see a very different portrait of him at a future time, after he's gone through the fearful adventures yet to be related. My uncle was 50 years old, tall, thin, and wiry. Large spectacles hid to a certain extent his vast, round, and goggle eyes, while his nose was irreverently compared to a thin file. So much, indeed, did it resemble that useful article that a compass was said in his presence to have made considerable deviation. The truth being told, however, the only article really attracted to my uncle's nose was tobacco. Another peculiarity of his was that he always stepped a yard at a time, clenched his fists as if he were going to hit you, and was, when in one of his peculiar humors, very far from a pleasant companion. It's further necessary to observe that he lived in a very nice house, in that very nice street, the Königstrasse, in Hamburg. Though lying in the center of town, it was perfectly rural in its aspect, half wood, half bricks, with old-fashioned gables, one of the few old houses spared by the Great Fire of 1842. When I say a nice house, I mean a handsome house, old, tottering, and not exactly comfortable to English notions, a house a little off the perpendicular and inclined to fall into the neighboring canal, exactly the house for a wandering artist to depict. All the more that you could scarcely see it for ivy and a magnificent old tree which grew over the door. My uncle was rich. His house was his own property, and he had a considerable private income. To my notion, the best part of his possessions was his goddaughter, Gretchen. And the old cook, the young lady, the professor, and I were the sole inhabitants. I loved mineralogy. I loved geology. To me, there was nothing like pebbles. And if my uncle had been in a little less of a fury, we should have been the happiest of families. To prove the excellent Hardwigg's impatience, I solemnly declare that when the flowers in the drawing-room pots began to grow, he rose every morning at 4 o'clock to make them grow quicker by pulling the leaves. Having described my uncle, I will now give an account of our interview. He received me in his study, a perfect museum containing every natural curiosity that can well be imagined, minerals, however, predominating. Every one was familiar to me, having been catalogued by my own hand. My uncle, apparently oblivious of the fact that he had summoned me to his presence, was absorbed in a book. He was particularly fond of early editions, tall copies, and unique works. "Wonderful," he cried, tapping his forehead. "Wonderful, wonderful." It was one of those yellow-leaved volumes now rarely found on stalls, and to me it appeared to possess but little value. My uncle, however, was in raptures. He admired its binding, the clearness of its characters, the ease with which it opened in his hand, and repeated aloud half a dozen times that it was very, very old. To my fancy, he was making a great fuss about nothing. But it wasn't my province to say so. On the contrary, I professed considerable interest in the subject, and asked him what it was about. "It is the Heimskringla of Snorri Tarlason," he said, "the celebrated Icelandic author of the 12th century. It is a true and correct account of the Norwegian princes who reigned in Iceland." My next question related to the language in which it was written. I hoped, at all events, it was translated into German. My uncle was indignant at the very thought, and declared he wouldn't give a penny for a translation. His delight was to have found the original work in the Icelandic tongue, which he declared to be one of the most magnificent and yet simple idioms in the world, while at the same time its grammatical combinations were the most varied known to students. "About as easy as German?" was my insidious remark. My uncle shrugged his shoulders. "The letters, at all events," I said, "are rather difficult of comprehension. It is a runic manuscript, the language of the original population of Iceland, invented by Odin himself," cried my uncle, angry at my ignorance. I was about to venture upon some misplaced joke on the subject, when a small scrap of parchment fell out of the leaves. Like a hungry man snatching at a morsel of bread, the professor seized it. It was about 5 inches by 3, and was scrawled over in the most extraordinary fashion. The lines written on the venerable piece of parchment have wonderful importance, as they induced my uncle to undertake the most wonderful series of adventures which ever fell to the lot of human beings. My uncle looked keenly at the document for some moments, and then declared that it was runic. The letters were similar to those in the book. But then what did they mean? This was exactly what I wanted to know. Now, as I had a strong conviction that the runic alphabet and dialect were simply an invention to mystify poor human nature, I was delighted to find that my uncle knew as much about the matter as I did, which was nothing. At all events, the tremulous motion of his fingers made me think so. "And yet," he muttered to himself, "it is old Icelandic, I'm sure of it." And my uncle ought to have known, for he was a perfect polyglot dictionary in himself. He didn't pretend, like a certain learned pundit, to speak the 2,000 languages and 4,000 idioms made use of in different parts of the globe, but he did know all the more important ones. It's a matter of great doubt to me now to what violent measures my uncle's impetuosity might have led him, had not the clock struck 2, and our old French cook called out to let us know that dinner was on the table. "Bother the dinner!" cried my uncle. But I was hungry. I sallied forth to the dining room, where I took up my usual quarters. Out of politeness, I waited 3 minutes, but no sign of my uncle, the professor. I was surprised. He wasn't usually so blind to the pleasure of a good dinner. It was the acme of German luxury. Parsley soup, a ham omelet with sorrel trimmings, an oyster of veal stewed with prunes, delicious fruit, and sparkling Moselle. For the sake of poring over this musty old piece of parchment, my uncle forbore to share our meal. To satisfy my conscience, I ate for both. The old cook and housekeeper was nearly out of her mind. After taking so much trouble to find her master not appear at dinner was to her a sad disappointment, which, as she occasionally watched the havoc I was making on the viands, became also alarm. What if my uncle were to come to table after all? Suddenly, just as I'd consumed the last apple and drunk the last glass of wine, a terrible voice was heard at no great distance. It was my uncle, roaring for me to come to him. I made very nearly one leap of it, so loud, so fierce was his tone. Chapter 2. The Mysterious Parchment. "I declare," cried my uncle, striking the table fiercely with his fist, "I declare to you it's runic, and contains some wonderful secret which I must get at any price." I was about to reply when he stopped me. "Sit down," he said fiercely, "and write to my dictation." I obeyed. "I will substitute," he said, "a letter of our alphabet for that of the runic. We will then see what that will produce. Now, begin, and make no mistakes." The dictation commenced with incomprehensible result. Scarcely giving me time to finish, my uncle snatched the document from my hands and examined it with the most rapt and deep attention. "I should like to know what it means," he said after a long period. I certainly couldn't tell him, nor did he expect me to, his conversation being uniformly answered by himself. "I declare it puts me in mind of a cryptograph," he cried. "Unless, indeed, the letters have been written without any real meaning, and yet why take so much trouble? Who knows, but I may be on the verge of some great discovery." My candid opinion was that it was all rubbish. But this opinion I kept carefully to myself, as my uncle's collar wasn't pleasant to bear. All this time he was comparing the book with the parchment. "The manuscript volume and the smaller document are written in different hands," he said. "The cryptograph is of much later date than the book. There's an undoubted proof of the correctness of my surmise." An irrefragable proof I took it to be. "The first letter is a double M, which was only added to the Icelandic language in the 12th century. This makes the parchment 200 years posterior to the volume." The circumstances appeared very probable and very logical, but it was all surmise to me. "To me, it appears probable that this sentence was written by some owner of the book. Now, who was the owner is the next important question. Perhaps by great good luck it may be written somewhere in the volume." With these words, Professor Hardwigg took off his spectacles and, taking a powerful magnifying glass, examined the book carefully. On the flyleaf was what appeared to be a blot of ink, but on examination proved to be a line of writing effaced by time. This was what he sought, and after some considerable time, he made out the runic letters of a name. "Arne Saknussum," he cried in a joyous and triumphant tone. "That's not only an Icelandic name, but of a learned professor of the 16th century, a celebrated alchemist." I bowed a token of respect. "These alchemists," he continued, "Avicenna, Bacon, Lully, Paracelsus, were the true, the only learned men of the day. They made surprising discoveries. May not this Saknussum, nephew mine, have hidden on this bit of parchment some astounding invention? I believe the cryptograph to have a profound meaning, which I must make out." My uncle walked about the room in a state of excitement almost impossible to describe. "It may be so, sir," I timidly observed, "but why conceal it from posterity, if it be a useful, a worthy discovery?"
"Why, how should I know? Did not Galileo make a secret of his discoveries in connection with Saturn? But we shall see. Until I discover the meaning of this sentence, I will neither eat nor sleep."
"My dear uncle," I began.
"Nor you neither," he added.
It was lucky I'd taken double allowance that day.
"In the first place," he continued, "there must be a clue to the meaning. If we could find that, the rest would be easy enough."
I began seriously to reflect. The prospect of going without food and sleep was not a promising one, so I determined to do my best to solve the mystery. My uncle, meanwhile, went on with his soliloquy.
"The way to discover it is easy enough. In this document, there are 132 letters, giving 79 consonants to 53 vowels. This is about the proportion found in most southern languages, the idioms of the north being much more rich in consonants. We may confidently predict, therefore, that we have to deal with a southern dialect. Nothing could be more logical. Now, said Professor Hardwigg, to trace the particular language.
As Shakespeare says, that is the question, was my rather satirical reply.
This man, Saknussemm, he continued, was a very learned man. Now, as he didn't write in the language of his birthplace, he probably, like most learned men of the 16th century, wrote in Latin. If, however, I prove wrong in this guess, we must try Spanish, French, Italian, Greek, and even Hebrew. My own opinion, though, is decidedly in favor of Latin.
This proposition startled me. Latin was my favorite study, and it seemed sacrilege to believe this gibberish to belong to the country of Virgil.
Barbarous Latin, in all probability, continued my uncle, but still, Latin.
Very probably, I replied, not to contradict him.
Let us see into the matter, continued my uncle. Here you see we have a series of 132 letters, apparently thrown pell-mell upon paper, without method or organization. There are words which are composed wholly of consonants, such as umrenals. Others which are nearly all vowels, the fifth, for instance, which is untief, and one of the last, oseibo. This appears an extraordinary combination. Probably we shall find that the phrase is arranged according to some mathematical plan. No doubt a certain sentence has been written out and then jumbled up, some plan to which some figure is the clue. Now, Harry, to show your English wit, what is that figure?
I could give him no hint. My thoughts were indeed far away. While he was speaking, I'd caught sight of the portrait of my cousin Gretchen and was wondering when she'd return. We were affianced and loved one another very sincerely. But my uncle, who never thought of such sublunary matters, knew nothing of this. Without noticing my abstraction, the professor began reading the puzzling cryptograph all sorts of ways, according to some theory of his own. Presently, rousing my wandering attention, he dictated one precious attempt to me. I mildly handed it over to him. It read as follows.
Messen ka senra ise dok segne tam urten esert sereta ro tavis adua kama ed nek sedna sadni la kerni ii lu ju sir sak ta sartab mutalabile mek meritarix lu ko islefen sni.
I could scarcely keep from laughing, while my uncle, on the contrary, got into a towering passion, struck the table with his fist, darted out of the room, out of the house, and then, taking to his heels, was presently lost to sight. Chapter 3. An Astounding Discovery.
What is the matter? Cried the cook, entering the room. When will master have his dinner?
Never.
And his supper?
I don't know. He says he will eat no more, neither shall I. My uncle has determined to fast and make me fast until he makes out this abominable inscription, I replied.
You will be starved to death, she said.
I was very much of the same opinion, but not liking to say so, sent her away and began some of my usual work of classification. But try as I might, nothing could keep me from thinking alternately of the stupid manuscript and of the pretty Gretchen. Several times I thought of going out, but my uncle would have been angry at my absence. At the end of an hour, my allotted task was done. How to pass the time? I began by lighting my pipe. Like all other students, I delighted in tobacco, and seating myself in the great armchair, I began to think. Where was my uncle? I could easily imagine him tearing along some solitary road, gesticulating, talking to himself, cutting the air with his cane, and still thinking of the absurd bit of hieroglyphics. Would he hit upon some clue? Would he come home in better humor? While these thoughts were passing through my brain, I mechanically took up the execrable puzzle and tried every imaginable way of grouping the letters. I put them together by twos, by threes, fours, and fives in vain. Nothing intelligible came out, except that the 14th, 15th, and 16th made ice in English. The 84th, 85th, and 86th the word sir. Then, at last, I seemed to find the Latin words rota, mutabile, ira, nec, atra. There seems to be some truth in my uncle's notion, thought I. Then again, I seemed to find the word luco, which means sacred wood. Then in the third line, I appeared to make out labeled, a perfect Hebrew word. And at the last, the syllables mer, ar, and mer, which were French. It was enough to drive one mad. Four different idioms in this absurd phrase. What connection could there be between ice, sir, anger, cruel, sacred wood, changing, mother, R, and C? The first and the last might, in a sentence connected with Iceland, mean sea of ice. But what of the rest of this monstrous cryptograph? I was, in fact, fighting against an insurmountable difficulty. My brain was almost on fire. My eyes were strained with staring at the parchment. The whole absurd collection of letters appeared to dance before my vision in a number of black little groups. My mind was possessed with temporary hallucination. I was stifling. I wanted air. Mechanically, I fanned myself with a document, of which now I saw the back and then the front. Imagine my surprise when, glancing at the back of the wearisome puzzle, the ink having gone through, I clearly made out Latin words, and among others, craterem and terrestre. I had discovered the secret. It came upon me like a flash of lightning. I had got the clue. All you had to do to understand the document was to read it backwards. All the ingenious ideas of the professor were realized. He dictated it rightly to me. By a mere accident, I'd discovered what he so much desired. My delight, my emotion, may be imagined. My eyes were dazzled and I trembled so that at first I could make nothing of it. One look, however, would tell me all I wished to know. Let me read, I said to myself after drawing a long breath. I spread it before me on the table. I passed my finger over each letter. I spelt it through. In my excitement, I read it out. What horror and stupefaction took possession of my soul. I was like a man who had received a knockdown blow. Was it possible that I really read the terrible secret, and it had really been accomplished? A man had dared to do what? No living being should ever know. Never, I cried, jumping up. Never shall my uncle be made aware of the dread secret. He would be quite capable of undertaking the terrible journey. Nothing would check him, nothing stop him. Worse, he would compel me to accompany him, and we should be lost forever. But no, such folly and madness cannot be allowed. I was almost beside myself with rage and fury. My worthy uncle is already nearly mad, I cried aloud. This would finish him. By some accident he may make the discovery, in which case we're both lost. Perish the fearful secret. Let the flames forever bury it in oblivion. I snatched up book and parchment and was about to cast them into the fire when the door opened and my uncle entered. I'd scarcely time to put down the wretched documents before my uncle was by my side. He was profoundly absorbed. His thoughts were evidently bent on the terrible parchment. Some new combination had probably struck him while taking his walk. He seated himself in his armchair and with a pen began to make an algebraic calculation. I watched him with anxious eyes. My flesh crawled as it became probable that he would discover the secret. His combinations, I knew, now were useless, I having discovered the one and only clue. For 3 mortal hours he continued without speaking a word, without raising his head, scratching, rewriting, calculating over and over again. I knew that in time he must hit upon the right phrase. The letters of every alphabet have only a certain number of combinations. But then years might elapse before he would arrive at the correct solution. Still, time went on. Night came, the sounds in the streets ceased, and still my uncle went on, not even answering our worthy cook when she called us to supper. I didn't dare to leave him, so waved her away and at last fell asleep on the sofa. When I awoke, my uncle was still at work. His red eyes, his pallid countenance, his matted hair, his feverish hands, his hectically flushed cheeks showed how terrible had been his struggle with the impossible, and what fearful fatigue he had undergone during that long, sleepless night. It made me quite ill to look at him. Though he was rather severe with me, I loved him, and my heart ached at his sufferings. He was so overcome by one idea that he couldn't even get in a passion. All his energies were focused on one point, and I knew that by speaking one little word, all this suffering would cease. I couldn't speak it. My heart was, nevertheless, inclining toward him. Why, then, did I remain silent? In the interest of my uncle himself. "Nothing shall make me speak," I muttered. "He will want to follow in the footsteps of the other. I know him well. His imagination is a perfect volcano, and to make discoveries in the interests of geology, he'd sacrifice his life. I will, therefore, be silent and strictly keep the secret I've discovered. To reveal it would be suicidal. He'd not only rush himself to destruction, but drag me with him." When our cook wanted to go out to market, or on any other errand, she found the front door locked and the key taken away. Was this done purposely or not? Surely Professor Hardwigg didn't intend the old woman and myself to become martyrs to his obstinate will. Were we to be starved to death? A frightful recollection came to my mind. Once we had fed on bits and scraps for a week while he sorted some curiosities. It gave me the cramp even to think of it. I wanted my breakfast, and I saw no way of getting it. Still, my resolution held good. I'd starve rather than yield. But the cook began to take me seriously to task. What was to be done? She could not go out, and I dared not. My uncle continued counting and writing. His imagination seemed to have transported him to the skies. He neither thought of eating nor drinking. In this way, 12 o'clock came round. I was hungry, and there was nothing in the house. The cook had eaten the last bit of bread. This couldn't go on. It did, however, until 2, when my sensations were terrible. After all, I began to think the document very absurd. Perhaps it might only be a gigantic hoax. Besides, some means would surely be found to keep my uncle back from attempting any such absurd expedition. On the other hand, if he did attempt anything so quixotic, I should not be compelled to accompany him. Another line of reasoning partially decided me. Very likely he would make the discovery himself when I should have suffered starvation for nothing. Under the influence of hunger, this reasoning appeared admirable. I determined to tell all. The question now arose as to how it was to be done. I was still dwelling on the thought when he rose and put on his hat. What? Go out and lock us in? Never. Uncle, I began. He didn't appear even to hear me. Professor Hardwigg, I cried. But, he retorted, did you speak? How about the key? What key? The key of the door? No, of these horrible hieroglyphics. He looked at me from under his spectacles and started at the odd expression of my face. Rushing forward, he clutched me by the arm and keenly examined my countenance. His very look was an interrogation. I simply nodded. With an incredulous shrug of the shoulders, he turned upon his heel. Undoubtedly, he thought I'd gone mad.
I have made a very important discovery.
His eyes flashed with excitement. His hand was lifted in a menacing attitude. For a moment, neither of us spoke. It's hard to say which was the most excited.
You don't mean to say that you have any idea of the meaning of the scrawl?
I do, was my desperate reply. Look at the sentence as dictated by you.
But it means nothing,
was the angry answer. Nothing if you read it from left to right. But mark, if from right to left...
Backwards!
Cried my uncle in wild amazement.
Oh, most cunning Saknussemm! And I to be such a blockhead!
He snatched up the document, gazed at it with haggard eye, and read it out as I had done. It read as follows. In Sneffels Joculus Craterem, Ken Delebet, Umbra Scartaris Julii Intra Calendis Descende, Audus Viator Et Terrestre Centrum Attinges, Code Faci, Arne Saknussemm. Which Dog Latin, being translated, reads as follows. Descend into the crater of Jokul of Sneffels, which the shade of Scartaris caresses, before the calends of July, audacious traveler, and you will reach the center of the earth. I did it. Arne Saknussemm. My uncle leaped 3 feet from the ground with joy. He looked radiant and handsome. He rushed about the room, wild with delight and satisfaction. He knocked over tables and chairs. He threw his books about until at last, utterly exhausted, he fell into his armchair.
"What's the o'clock?"
he asked. "About 3.
"My dinner does not seem to have done me much good," he observed. "Let me have something to eat. We can then start at once. Get my portmanteau ready."
"What for?"
"And your own," he continued. "We start at once."
My horror may be conceived. I resolved, however, to show no fear. Scientific reasons were the only ones likely to influence my uncle. Now, there were many against this terrible journey. The very idea of going down to the center of the earth was simply absurd. I determined, therefore, to argue the point after dinner. My uncle's rage was now directed against the cook for having no dinner ready. My explanation, however, satisfied him, and giving her the key, she soon contrived to get sufficient foods to satisfy our voracious appetites. During the repast, my uncle was rather gayer than otherwise. He made some of those peculiar jokes which belong exclusively to the learned. As soon, however, as dessert was over, he called me to his study. We each took a chair on opposite sides of the table.
"Harry," he said, in a soft and winning voice, "I've always believed you ingenious, and you've rendered me a service never to be forgotten. Without you, this great, this wondrous discovery would never have been made. It's my duty, therefore, to insist on your sharing the glory."
He's in a good humor, thought I. I'll soon let him know my opinion of glory.
"In the first place," he continued, "you must keep the whole affair a profound secret. There's no more envious race of men than scientific discoverers. Many would start on the same journey. At all events, we'll be the first in the field."
"I doubt you're having many competitors," was my reply.
"A man of real scientific acquirements would be delighted at the chance. We should find a perfect stream of pilgrims on the traces of Arne Saknussemm, if this document were once made public."
"But, my dear sir, is not this paper very likely to be a hoax?" I urged.
"The book in which we find it is sufficient proof of its authenticity," he replied.
"I thoroughly allow that the celebrated professor wrote the lines, but only, I believe, as a kind of mystification," was my answer. Scarcely were the words out of my mouth when I was sorry I'd uttered them. My uncle looked at me with a dark and gloomy scowl, and I began to be alarmed for the results of our conversation. His mood soon changed, however, and a smile took the place of a frown.
"We shall see," he remarked with decisive emphasis.
"But see, What is all this about Yokel and Sneffels and this Scartaris? I've never heard anything about them.
The very point to which I'm coming. I lately received from my friend Augustus Petermann of Leipzig a map. Take down the third atlas from the second shelf, Series Z, Plate 4.
I rose and went to the shelf and presently returned with the volume indicated.
This, said my uncle, is one of the best maps of Iceland. I believe it will settle all your doubts, difficulties, and objections.
With a grim hope to the contrary, I stooped over the map. Chapter 4. We start on the journey.
You see, the whole island is composed of volcanoes, said the professor. And remark carefully that they all bear the name of Jökull. The word is Icelandic and means a glacier. In most of the lofty mountains of that region, the volcanic eruptions come forth from ice-bound caverns, hence the name applied to every volcano on this extraordinary island.
But what does this word Sneffels mean? To this question, I expected no rational answer. I was mistaken.
Follow my finger to the western coast of Iceland. There you see Reykjavik, its capital. Follow the direction of one of its innumerable fjords or arms of the sea. And what do you see below the 65th degree of latitude?
A peninsula, very like a thigh bone in shape.
And in the center of it?
A mountain.
Well, that's Sneffels.
I had nothing to say.
That is Sneffels, a mountain about 5,000 feet in height, one of the most remarkable in the whole island, and certainly doomed to be the most celebrated in the world, for through its crater we shall reach the center of the earth.
Impossible! Cried I, startled and shocked at the thought.
Why impossible? Said Professor Hardwigg in his severest tones.
Because its crater is choked with lava, by burning rocks, by infinite dangers.
But if it be extinct?
That would make a difference.
Of course it would. There are about 300 volcanoes on the whole surface of the globe, but the greater number are extinct. Of these, Sneffels is one. No eruption has occurred since 1219. In fact, it has ceased to be a volcano at all.
After this, what more could I say?
Yes, I thought of another objection.
But what's all this about Scartaris and the calends of July? My uncle reflected deeply. Presently, he gave forth the result of his reflections in a sententious tone.
What appears obscure to you, to me, is light. This very phrase shows how particular Saknussemm is in his directions. The Sneffels mountain has many craters. He's careful, therefore, to note the exact one which is the highway into the interior of the earth. He lets us know, for this purpose, that about the end of the month of June, the shadow of Mount Scartaris falls upon the one crater. There can be no doubt about the matter.
My uncle had an answer for everything. I accept all your explanations, I said, and Saknussemm is right. He found out the entrance to the bowels of the earth. He has indicated correctly, but that he or anyone else ever followed up the discovery is madness to suppose.
Why so, young man?
All scientific teaching, theoretical and practical, shows it to be impossible.
I care nothing for theories, retorted my uncle.
But is it not well known that heat increases 1 degree for every 70 feet you descend into the earth? Which gives a fine idea of the central heat. All the matters which compose the globe are in a state of incandescence. Even gold, platinum, and the hardest rocks are in a state of fusion. What would become of us?
Don't be alarmed at the heat, my boy.
How so?
Neither you nor anybody else knows anything about the real state of the Earth's interior. All modern experiments tend to explode the older theories. Were any such heat to exist, the upper crust of the Earth would be shattered to atoms, and the world would be at an end.
A long, learned, and not uninteresting discussion followed, which ended in this way.
I do not believe the dangers and difficulties which you, Harry, seem to multiply. And the only way to learn is, like Arnis Acnusum, to go and see.
Well, cried I, overcome at last, let us go and see. Though how we can do that in the dark is another mystery.
Fear nothing. We shall overcome these and many other difficulties. Besides, as we approach the center, I expect to find it luminous.
Nothing is impossible.
And now that we have come to a thorough understanding, not a word to any living soul. Our success depends on secrecy and dispatch.
Thus ended our memorable conference, which roused a perfect fever in me. Leaving my uncle, I went forth like one possessed. Reaching the banks of the Elbe, I began to think. Was all I had heard really and truly possible? Was my uncle in his sober senses, and could the interior of the earth be reached? Was I the victim of a madman, or was he a discoverer of rare courage and grandeur of conception? To a certain extent, I was anxious to be off. I was afraid my enthusiasm would cool. I determined to pack up at once. At the end of an hour, however, on my way home, I found that my feelings had very much changed. I'm all abroad, I cried. It's a nightmare. I must have dreamed it. At this moment, I came face to face with Gretchen, whom I warmly embraced. So, you've come to meet me, she said. How good of you. But what's the matter? Well, it was no use mincing the matter. I told her all. She listened with awe, and for some minutes she couldn't speak. Well? I at last said, rather anxiously.
What a magnificent journey! If I were only a man, a journey worthy of the nephew of Professor Hardwigg, I should look upon it as an honor to accompany him.
My dear Gretchen, I thought you'd be the first to cry out against this mad enterprise.
No, on the contrary, I glory in it. It's magnificent, splendid, an idea worthy of my father. Harry Lawson, I envy you.
This was, as it were, conclusive, the final blow of all. When we entered the house, we found my uncle surrounded by workmen and porters who were packing up. He was pulling and hauling at a bell.
Where have you been wasting your time? Your portmanteau isn't packed. My papers aren't in order. The precious tailor hasn't brought my clothes nor my gaiters. The key of my carpet bag is gone.
I looked at him, stupefied, and still he tugged away at the bell. We're really off then? I said.
Yes, of course. And yet you go out for a stroll, unfortunate boy.
And when do we go?
The day after tomorrow, at daybreak.
I heard no more, but darted off to my little bedchamber and locked myself in. There was no doubt about it now. My uncle had been hard at work all the afternoon. The garden was full of ropes, rope ladders, torches, gourds, iron clamps, crowbars, alpenstocks, and pickaxes, enough to load 10 men. I passed a terrible night. I was called early the next day to learn that the resolution of my uncle was unchanged and irrevocable. I also found my cousin and affianced wife as warm on the subject as was her father. Next day, at 5 o'clock in the morning, the post chaise was at the door. Gretchen and the old cook received the keys of the house, and scarcely pausing to wish anyone goodbye, we started on our adventurous journey into the center of the earth. Chapter 5. First Lessons in Climbing. At Alten, a suburb of Hamburg, is the chief station of the Kiel Railway, which was to take us to the shores of the Belt. In 20 minutes from the moment of our departure, we were in Holstein, and our carriage entered the station. Our heavy luggage was taken out, weighed, labeled, and placed in a huge van. We then took our tickets, and exactly at 7 o'clock we were seated opposite each other in a first-class railway carriage. My uncle said nothing. He was too busy examining his papers, among which, of course, was the famous parchment, and some letters of introduction from the Danish consul, which were to pave the way to an introduction to the governor of Iceland. My only amusement was looking out of the window. But as we passed through a flat, though fertile, country, this occupation was slightly monotonous. In 3 hours, we reached Kiel, and our baggage was at once transferred to the steamer. We had now a day before us, a delay of about 10 hours, which fact put my uncle in a towering passion. We had nothing to do but to walk about the pretty town and bay. At length, however, we went on board, and at 10:30 were steaming down the Great Belt. It was a dark night, with a strong breeze and a rough sea, nothing being visible but the occasional fires on shore, with here and there a lighthouse. At 7 a.m, we left Korsør, a little town on the western side of Zealand. Here we took another railway, which in 3 hours brought us to the capital, Copenhagen, where, scarcely taking time for refreshment, my uncle hurried out to present one of his letters of introduction. It was to the director of the Museum of Antiquities, who, having been informed that we were tourists bound for Iceland, did all he could to assist us. One wretched hope sustained me now. Perhaps no vessel was bound for such distant parts. Alas, a little Danish schooner, the Valkyrie, was to sail on the 2nd of June for Reykjavik. The captain, M. Bjarne, was on board, and was rather surprised at the energy and cordiality with which his future passenger shook him by the hand. To him, a voyage to Iceland was merely a matter of course. My uncle, on the other hand, considered the event of sublime importance. The honest sailor took advantage of the professor's enthusiasm to double the fare. On Tuesday morning, at 7:00, be on board, said M. Bjarne, handing us our receipts. Excellent! Capital! Glorious! Remarked my uncle, as we sat down to a late breakfast. Refresh yourself, my boy, and we'll take a run through the town. Our meal concluded, we went to the Kongens Nytorv, to the king's magnificent palace, to the beautiful bridge over the canal near the museum, to the immense cenotaph of Torvaldsen, with its hideous naval groups, to the castle of Rosenberg, and to all the other lions of the place, none of which my uncle even saw, so absorbed was he in his anticipated triumphs. But one thing struck his fancy, and that was a certain singular steeple situated on the island of Amak, which is the southeast quarter of the city of Copenhagen. My uncle at once ordered me to turn my steps that way, and accordingly, we went on board the steam ferryboat which does duty on the canal, and very soon reached the noted dockyard quay. In the first instance, we crossed some narrow streets where we met numerous groups of galley slaves, with party-colored trousers, gray and yellow, and finally reached the Forfrelsers Kirk. This church exhibited nothing remarkable in itself. In fact, the worthy professor had only been attracted to it by one circumstance, which was that its rather elevated steeple started from a circular platform, after which there was an exterior staircase which wound round to the very summit. "Let us ascend," said my uncle. "But I never climb church towers," I cried. "I'm subject to dizziness in my head."
"The very reason you should go to the top. I want to cure you of a bad habit."
"But my good sir,
I tell you to come. What's the use of wasting so much valuable time?"
It was impossible to dispute the dictatorial commands of my uncle. I yielded with a groan. On payment of a fee, the verger gave us the key. He, for one, was not partial to the ascent. My uncle at once showed me the way, running up the steps like a schoolboy. I followed as well as I could, though no sooner was I outside the tower than my head began to swim. There was nothing of the eagle about me. The earth was enough for me, and no ambitious desire to soar ever entered my mind. Still, things didn't go badly until I descended 150 steps and was near the platform, when I began to feel the rush of cold air. I could scarcely stand, when, clutching the railings, I looked upwards. The railing was frail enough, but nothing to those which skirted the terrible winding staircase that appeared from where I stood to ascend to the skies.
"Now then, Harry,"
I can't do it, I cried in accents of despair.
Are you, after all, a coward, sir? Said my uncle, in a pitiless tone. Go up, I say.
To this there was no reply possible. And yet the keen air acted violently on my nervous system. Sky, earth, all seemed to swim around, while the steeple rocked like a ship. My legs gave way like those of a drunken man. I crawled upon my hands and knees. I hauled myself up slowly, crawling like a snake. Presently I closed my eyes and allowed myself to be dragged upwards.
Look around you, said my uncle in a stern voice. Heaven knows what profound abysses you may have to look down. This is excellent practice.
Slowly, and shivering all the while with cold, I opened my eyes. What then did I see? My first glance was upwards at the cold, fleecy clouds, which, as by some optical delusion, appeared to stand still while the steeple, the weathercock, and our two selves were carried swiftly along. Far away on one side could be seen the grassy plain, while on the other lay the sea, bathed in translucent light. The Sund, or Sound, as we call it, could be discovered beyond the point of Elsinore, crowded with white sails, which, at that distance, looked like the wings of seagulls, while to the east could be made out the far-off coast of Sweden. The whole appeared a magic panorama. But faint and bewildered as I was, there was no remedy for it. Rise and stand up I must. Despite my protestations, my first lesson lasted quite an hour. When nearly 2 hours later I reached the bosom of Mother Earth, I was like a rheumatic old man bent double with pain.
Enough for one day, said my uncle, rubbing his hands. We'll begin again tomorrow.
There was no remedy. My lessons lasted 5 days, and at the end of that period, I ascended blithely enough and found myself able to look down into the depths below without even winking, and with some degree of pleasure. Chapter 6. Our Voyage to Iceland. The hour of departure came at last. The night before, the worthy Mr. Thompson brought us the most cordial letters of introduction for Baron Trompa, governor of Iceland, for Monsieur Picturson, co-adjutor to the bishop, and for Monsieur Finson, mayor of the town of Reykjavik. In return, my uncle nearly crushed his hand, so warmly did he shake them. On the 2nd of the month, at 2 in the morning, our precious cargo of luggage was taken on board the good ship Valkyrie. We followed and were very politely introduced by the captain to a small cabin with 2 standing bed places, neither very well ventilated nor very comfortable. But in the cause of science, men are expected to suffer.
Well, and have we a fair wind? Cried my uncle in most mellifluous accents.
An excellent wind, replied Captain Bjarne. We shall leave the Sound going free with all sails set. A few minutes afterwards, the schooner started before the wind under all the canvas she could carry and entered the channel. An hour later, the capital of Denmark seemed to sink into the waves, and we were at no great distance from the coast of Elsinore. My uncle was delighted. For myself, moody and dissatisfied, I appeared almost to expect a glimpse of the ghost of Hamlet. Sublime madman, thought I. You doubtless would approve our proceedings. You might perhaps even follow us to the center of the earth, there to resolve your eternal doubts. But no ghost or anything else appeared upon the ancient walls. The fact is, the castle is much later than the time of the heroic prince of Denmark. It's now the residence of the keeper of the Strait of the Sound, and through that sound, more than 15,000 vessels of all nations pass every year. The castle of Kronborg soon disappeared in the murky atmosphere, as well as the tower of Helsingborg, which raises its head on the Swedish bank. And here the schooner began to feel in earnest the breezes of the Kattegat. The Valkyrie was swift enough, but with all sailing boats, there's the same uncertainty. Her cargo was coal, furniture, pottery, woolen clothing, and a load of corn. As usual, the crew was small. 5 Danes doing the whole of the work.
How long will the voyage last? Asked my uncle.
Well, I should think about 10 days, replied the skipper. unless indeed we meet with some northeast gales among the Faroe Islands. At all events, there'll be no very considerable delay, cried the impatient professor. No, Mr. Hardwigg, said the captain, no fear of that. At all events, we shall get there some day. Toward evening, the schooner doubled Cape Skagen, the northernmost part of Denmark, crossed the Skagerrak during the night, skirted the extreme point of Norway through the gut of Cape Lindness, and then reached the northern seas. 2 days later, we were not far from the coast of Scotland, somewhere near what Danish sailors call Peterhead. And then the Valkyrie stretched out direct for the Faroe Islands, between Orkney and Shetland. Our vessel now felt the full force of the ocean waves and the wind shifting. We, with great difficulty, made the Faroe Islands. On the eighth day, the captain made out Meganess, the westernmost of the isles, and from that moment headed direct for Portland, a cape on the southern shores of the singular island for which we were bound.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.